Still people are joining. All right. Just to double check, you can see my slides. Yeah, I see hands up, so that's great. So today I'm presenting my PhD research. I'm finishing up my PhD. I'm at the Faculty of Industrial Design Engineering at the Delft University of Technology. So actually really a design faculty. My supervisors are Professor Smulders from TU Delft, Professor Simpson from Strathclyde, Professor Lorena from ISEC, and Dr. Van der Beltrouwer from the TU Delft. And I want to talk today about the organization design, obviously, and kind of like the work that I'm doing on developing a pragmatist perspective on organization design and why and how that might be interesting. And kind of like the motivation of my inquiry is that I, in my studies, I was studying both design for a couple of years here in Delft, but also I was doing a business studies master. And so I kind of like have these two sides of myself. Of someone interested in organizing management business, but also interested in design. And that reading about design in organization studies was sometimes a bit surprising to me. And I was feeling like, hey, I want to do something with this feeling, because there's some things that don't really match up. And it took me quite some time to really understand why that actually is. And so it kind of like rolls, I think, around this, that organization design, in a way, of course, brings together different insights. On the one hand, it's quite an old field for organization studies. Some argue even that it's the heart of organizational theory. At the same time, design studies, as the field that really is focused on developing an understanding of the design process and has this processual perspective on design, is also starting to get into the topic of organization design. But there's quite different assumptions behind it, quite different perspectives behind it. So at times it seemed for me quite challenging to really bring these together. And this is not my research question, but it's kind of like the question, I guess, in a way that also has been driving me. It's kind of like, how design is organization design? What perspective on design is behind the perspective of organization design, of much work in organization design? At the same time, you have some scholars arguing that there's a shift in paradigms happening in the field of organization design. So you might know the book by, I'm not sure how to pronounce his name, Magalhães, 2020, so it came out last year. Designing organization design, Snow and Felschet are working on an upcoming book where they argue about this. And so because the second presenter today is not presenting, I really would like your reactions throughout the presentation. So please don't hesitate to disagree with me, to ask questions. I'm very curious to have this more as a dialogue than just me presenting. So to kind of like get towards more of a problematization. So I came across the work of Alveson and Sandberg that you might know. They wrote an interesting article on the role that that problematization can play in research. So instead of just trying to find gaps and fill gaps, that we can also engage more in problematizing existing research and therefore have a different approach to how to engage in research. I also heavily draw on Dewey and the reason why will become apparent later. The important thing to remember is that this approach of problematization of paradigmatic assumptions means that you don't review all the literature, but instead you really try to focus on some key literature and try to bring out the paradigmatic assumptions and look at these and see, okay, are there maybe other assumptions that might be relevant and interesting for this field? And so the way that they look at it is the paradigmatic assumptions are made up of assumptions about ontology, epistemology, methodology, and drawing on Dewey, I also add axiology and sort of say also more practically the assumptions that play a role. And so I guess for most of you, all of this is quite obvious. You have, of course, tailored scientific management on organization design, kind of like the one best way, the technical rationality. You have Simon's more cognitive perspective, organization as information processing and the role of founder rationality, the role of contingency theory, environmental fits, then Galbraith's organization design with the STAR model, and the role of architecture in Nadler and Tushman's work. And looking at this, it seems that sort of say that the process or the cognitive perspective on organizations and the design science of Simon is quite dominant as a paradigm in organization design. And what that means is if you look at the assumptions, it's ontologically, so to say, it focuses on entity structures. That's why by organization design, a lot of times it's even defined as being about, so to say, the creation, the designing of structures. The epistemology is representational and individualistic. The axiology is a bit implicit. It's more embedding your worldview, your values in the design that you're making. And I wonder at times what the role of purpose then is. And then the methodology is looking at design as the outcome, as the product. It's theological, so to say, you define beforehand the solution that you're trying to, you define the problem and therefore also the solution. And then the question is more about implementation. It takes usually more of a top-down, an expert designer role that is somewhat separated from users. And in that sense, so to say, the older routines literature is quite exemplary for this kind of perspective. And in sort of say my working a bit through the literature, I came across a perspective that resonates obviously quite well with design studies, and that's some called it the creative organization design or creative organization design thinking. That's the work of Barry, Van de Ven, Garut, and others, where we shift more to a artistic and creative perspective on organization design than the more engineering or analytic perspective that is dominant, where it's more about effectiveness than efficiency, where we are going from designing for stability, designing structures, to what's more designing for innovation and generativity. And therefore, this kind of approach is especially interesting in complex, dynamic, and novel situations where there are novel and tasks and issues that require novel situations. So I'm not saying that sort of say other perspectives are not relevant. I'm just saying, like, I think especially for these kind of situations, maybe a different approach to organization design might be interesting. And then you might know the work of Garut, for example, when he talks about design for incompleteness, where his co-authors and Raghu critiqued Simon's design science, especially because it requires system boundaries or at least interfaces, especially between organization and environment. And that's the problem, therefore also the solution can be decomposed, or at least that you have some assemblies that you can deal with. But the problem is that if environments are dynamic and there are multiple designers, that kind of approach is quite difficult because you can't necessarily beforehand establish, okay, what is the problem and what should therefore be the solution. And Simon, in one of his chapters in Sciences of the Artificial, actually talks about this as planning without goals, a more pragmatic approach to design, so to say. And therefore, Garut et al. Argue that an incomplete approach to organization design might be interesting, where the design is, so to say, continuously adapted through the users in a kind of co-design process. In a later paper, a similar approach they term as neo-design, drawing again on Simon, who argued that design is concerned not with the necessary, but with the contingent, not with how things are, but how things may, how they might be. And in that sense, like drawing on the book of Simon, that planning without goals is a discovery process guided only by the most general heuristics of interestingness or novelty, where intermediary outcomes serve as the basis for further transformation. And the question is really sort of say how phenomena emerge through repurposing, experimentation, and more collective learning processes. And this is the kind of like the perspective that I try to go in, because it resonates quite well actually with design studies. Litka and Parma in 2012 noted as well that the design and organization design is more of a metaphor, but it's not really an analogy, so to say, for design. And that you have different perspectives also in organization studies that kind of like look at design as a process. So design thinking, design attitude. And if we look at design studies, there's actually next to Simon's design science, there's an important other paradigm that is design inquiry. But it seems like this perspective on design inquiry and reflective practice is virtually non-existent organization design. But that's actually a bit of a question, because I have not come across it, but maybe you have, or you know practitioners that have engaged this kind of work. But it seems like as if a lot of scholars in organization studies don't even realize that Schön is an important organization scholar, of course, but it's also actually a very important design scholar. And let me try to go a bit more into this. So what Schön wrote in his Reflective Practitioner from 1983 is that the designer does not keep means and ends separate, but defines them interactively as he frames the problematic situation. He does not separate thinking from doing, I don't know how to pronounce this word, ratiocinating his way to the decision, which he must later convert to action. So this might be quite a complex quote, but a lot of the assumptions about the design of Simon that Schön tries to go against in that sense are kind of like wrapped together here. So let me try to visualize it differently. If you compare Simon's design science versus Schön's design inquiry as two of the most important paradigms in design studies, at least, then Simon looks at design as more being about designing artifacts, while design inquiry in Schön's perspective is more about design as a reflective conversation with the materials of the situation, where Simon is more highlighting the role of problem definition. Schön is arguing that actually we can't really define the problem until we have the solution. So it's more about problem setting and the role of frames and reframing in the design process. If you would look at the solution, then Simon is more talking about a search process or a discovery process, while Schön is much more engaged in this kind of co-evolution of problem solution, where means and ends are not to be separate, but actually something that's related to each other. Very importantly in Simon, he talks about situations, but the important assumption he takes is that we can represent situations, that we can simulate and take that, so to say, as a representation of the world. While Schön, in a quite a different perspective, really places the designer in the situation and in transaction with the situation. And therefore, Simon's approach to inquiry is sort of say inspired by the sciences. So there's goals that are defined. There's a cognitive search process going on. Representation is very important. The hierarchy in the system and the nearly decomposable systems are very important. Well, Schoen is talking much more about the role of surprise, in that sense, kind of like your body, how you're surprised, the role of reflection and action, the role of experiments, and also very importantly, the role of reframing. If like with anything of this, you feel like you want to ask a question or have a comment or have a critique, please don't hesitate. I don't see any hands up, so.
No, I do.
Oh, please, yeah.
I think this is a wonderful framing of a very practical approach to design that I was talking about a few weeks ago, that basically you have to have senior management, which is more involved with setting goals, giving voice to people in the organization about their experience in the process of enacting the strategy or discovering strategy or direction, if you will. As you point out, these are interactive. So this calls for mechanisms for that kind of co-design,
yes,
between those who are in power and those who don't have the power to design, but know what the redesign has to be. That's what I really was talking about. People in the organization know where the tensions are in the system in terms of its capacity to enact the intended direction or the implicit direction, you know. And I find you have to have an explicit direction. And that can change, of course, because often the voice says, well, our strategy is not exactly right. You know, we really, here's what our customer, you know, people at the boundary of the organization know that the customers are seeing something different than what the organization is basically trying to do, or it's implicit assumptions or explicit assumptions about what it's trying to do. So this is terrific. This is, I just want to commend you. I'd love to get your slides and any papers you have. How do we make that? How can we do that? Because I'm going to have to get off in about 20 minutes. Yeah.
I guess, Rishika, we can accommodate that in some way. You can always find me, obviously.
On the internet?
On the internet, yes.
Okay. All right. Good. I'm glad to meet you. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to get off after a while. Thank you.
Okay. And so
on the website, so not a problem.
Yeah. And so maybe just to reiterate. So what I'm saying today, probably in a lot of ways, maybe doesn't sound new in the sense of that I think there's a couple of developments that are kind of like coming together. And my point today is more, I think there are kind of like some problematic assumptions about design that are at times existing in organization design. And that if we let them looser a bit and allow maybe for some less strict distinctions and in that sense kind of like see more, a more fluid approach to organization design might be interesting here. And I think what you just talked about, that reflects actually quite nicely the next slide that I'm trying to talk about. So I'll go on to that, but very interesting. Thank you, Michael. So just some insights from design studies that the last 40 years, but it's obviously like the big shift was in that sense Schoen's work. So I'm going a lot back to him. And that will become apparent later. But what Schoen really did is highlighted that design is an emergent process of designing. So where all too often design is seen in organization studies as a plan to be implemented, maybe even by other people, that design is really much more an emergent process where you are, so to say, in transaction with the situation and the goals and the means and the ends, they come out of this inquiry process. Schoen highlighted the role of that thinking and acting are not always separate, but at times even come together as reflection and action, and how important this reflection and action is. And Michael, I think this very much relates to your earlier point that the people that are sort of say interacting, say with the client, we need to allow them to engage in this kind of reflection and action and then be able to take that back to whoever decides on the goals, on the structures, etc. And therefore that users and designers are less split, because they need to become much more closer together, because if we're dealing with complex and dynamic situations.
Yeah, but just as another comment, hierarchy is the problem, okay? In organizations, hierarchy, it does not enable this approach, the Schoen approach, in a very effective way. That's really the problem.
Yeah, because the inquiry approach kind of like goes against the command and control hierarchy. Yeah, yeah. I'm not talking about hierarchy today, but implicitly that is a very important issue, absolutely.
From a practical point of view, that is really the key.
Yeah, yeah, I see that. That also actually relates to the next point, namely that we can't separate means and ends. So that usually a hierarchy and a command control structure means that we define the ends and then expect people to just find the means to fulfill those ends. But what if it turns out in the process that the ends are problematic? That we see actually this product, this structure, this way of organizing is not actually appropriate. And that you often is quite an issue to deal with that. And so in design, we talk about the co-evolution of problem solution, which is really a fundamentally different perspective, because it means that we cannot define problems before we have found something that looks like a solution. So that as we are looking for solutions, as we are creating solutions, we are also learning about the problem. And there's kind of like the back and forth where we learn about the solution, we learn about the problem, and then at some point they kind of like merge together. And also very importantly, the role of frames and reframing. Of course, Schoen has written about this in design, but he's also written about that in policy. So you also know the work of Schoen there on problem framing and reframing, etc. But these are really important insights that I think are also relevant for the topic of organization design.